I'll admit, like when I saw this film, I thought this was gonna be about black girls who are cheerleaders. I didn't realize everything they had to go through in order to just get to the point where they're doing it, you know? Like in all these taboos and elements that they had to navigate just to get there. And now I have an appreciation for that, and I'm hoping that other people gain the same, because that's a critical part of storytelling, is like recognizing what you don't know.
I just think it was very eye-opening to see that, and to see that with young girls especially, because I didn't have that experience. I was that only black girl in the squad. I was that girl that, one thing the film talked about was the hairstyles. I was that one black girl in the squad. I was like, I can't necessarily do the little hump thing because mine dies like right in the middle of the whole competition. It just looks like a little peacock is stuck on my head. That's not really cute. So they were like, oh, we have to accommodate to her. I've been that girl that's like, oh, we got to do something because Jasmine's hair. And it's like, but I'm natural. I love my hair. You know, I don't want to diminish that. I still want to be a part. And they're like, oh, we have to do an all updo because you can't. And I just felt so like, I don't want to say like inadequate, but I just felt like, wow, like they're hating on me almost. Like I can't help who I am. I can't help what genetics brought to me. I can't help what I have. So to be able to see girls like that and say like, we can't do those styles, but we do this and we have this sass and we have this whole thing going on. It's just so eye-opening, and it's been such an experience. And I'm so glad in 2019 that we are able to step up and have these conversations without it being a stigma, or like I said, like I was the only black girl, like, oh, we have to change it because of you, and whispering under the table, so.
Right. That's a good point, though. I mean, we don't always know the ramifications of our behavior, right? Mm-hmm. I love using art to prompt conversations, to build community. Is there a natural audience to take this film to and watch this together? What is this like, and what do we as cheerleaders, and I love that the term leaders even in there, you know, what do we stand for? We're part of this bigger system that's doing this to our sisters. Do we know this? And now that we know, what do we want to do with that?
When we started originally, it was to create a safe space, this very small community that we could share our experiences as being minorities in this sport. And then we decided to open up to a broader audience and show the world that black girls cheer and do so much more. But we, like we were saying during the break, one of the questions, and we get this probably at least once a week, someone comes on the page and they'll say, you know, Why do you need this? Or why is this necessary? Or, you know, they'll say, you're racist. You know, we've been accused of that. Why do you separate yourselves? Why do you think, you know, what would be, how would you feel if there was a white girl shirt? These are kind of all some form of the question of a questioning of why this is necessary. And so I was in a conversation recently. I was like, well, which answer? Am I give you a professional, polished up answer or just this real raw answer? Is that there already is a white girl shirt. That's what we've always seen. And the fact that we felt like we needed to do this is the reason that it needs to be done. Because there wasn't a space for us where we were able to see ourselves in those ways of being seen as beautiful, as being seen as graceful, that we were esteemed and upheld and celebrated. When we looked at the images before, whether that was in print, social media, there were just no girls that looked like my girls, you know? And it was always disheartening.
Yeah, and I'm struck by just how that idea that you have to be different, the hair strikes me more than anything else, this idea that your hair has to be a certain way in order to be acceptable, and the anxiety that must surround that until you finally recognize, oh, I'm free to be myself, I can be, you know, what naturally I feel inclined to be, and how liberating that must be.
My daughter was applying to go to Hampton, and if you look at her college admission application, she talks about her hair, realizing that, oh, I can get up and be natural and just be myself, and no one's gonna single me out, or no one's gonna say something about it. It was like, it freed them.
Yeah. Same for me, it was the same thing that I didn't know that was acceptable. I remember having clip-ins in my hair because to have it straightened, I would have to get up every morning, straighten my hair, and make sure that it all was clean. And then I went to HECU and they're like, why are you doing all this? Just go as you are. Like, don't do that to your hair. Go ahead, it's fine. So I think that the film brings that to the forefront. And if we can show that to our younger generation, like, here, this is what kids your age are going through in the same element in the different parts of the country, and that you're not alone, so.
And it makes the world a difference, because then you know it's possible. And I have a saying that you cannot be what you do not see. You gotta see it in some way. And it may not be a literal translation, but you gotta see something that you can hold on to and know that it's possible.
I think about how difficult it is for children in general to develop a sense of identity today. One girl was describing to me recently, like, oh, it's identity traffic that we're dealing with between our online identities and our identities with our friends. To your point, if you don't even have a reference point, there's nobody out there that looks like me, so I don't even have a hero or an idol or even just a reference that says, that looks like me, that could be me one day. You know, how important that is in the development of one's own identity is crucial. Yeah, right. And you're providing that, yeah.
We're trying to do more. Mm-hmm. You know, we want to elevate. When I start thinking about like next steps, now how do we now become more inclusive, where we are a part of the decision making, where we are a part of organizations having conversations? Where's the training? Where's the education for the staff? And again, I keep going back because I think that education conversations are just necessary so that we can open it up. And so that we can take the taboo stigma off of it. Because it's not really, it is that, it's not as bad as we think it is. No one's gonna break up with you because we don't necessarily agree on something.
Right.
Let's just have a conversation about it.
And I'll add that I feel good about this generation of kids right now. You know, I think they're more open and inclusive and thoughtful. So if there's a space for a broader movement, I think now's the time for that.
And I think the film is a beautiful work of art and story, powerful stories, to your point of visibility and voice, right? We all want to be seen and heard. That is just across human beings. We all want to be seen and heard, and that's the platform that you're giving here. And so to use something where we can all invite in our inner child, right? That youngest part of ourselves that wants to belong, wants a sisterhood, and wants to be lifted up. I think it's just a wonderful place to begin this very necessary conversation.